Dr. Nkrumah, main architect of Ghana's independence, this is a day of fulfillment. The longing to be free, the need to be free, these are part of the rightful heritage of man, a heritage denied to colonial Africa until now.
So people say we are post-independent, right? But in terms of post-independence is time. So yeah, we are post-independent 1963, but in terms of like anti-colonial struggle, trying to, the imperative to dismantle the colonial underpinnings of our society, we are still basically, maybe we are in November 1957. We haven't done much since the overthrow of Kwame Nkrumah. Like most societies, when we talk about struggle, it's very leadership based. People look to the leaders, and of course, the visible leaders have always been men. And the problem with excluding women from the narrative, you know, not only excluding women, but excluding even poorer men, is that it makes people feel like women and even poorer men, less privileged men, cannot contribute to struggles within our country. So the real big issue is not just that women's contribution to our independence struggle has been erased, but it entrenches a view now that women cannot contribute to such efforts, which is a problem for us now because we really can't afford for Ghanaian women to feel like they can't lead change in Ghana. You see, so number one, we need to assert the position of women in our independence struggle so that we can then empower ourselves to do the things we need to do for Ghana. Because if you do not see yourself in certain places, you're not going to want to be there. You know, you're not going to think yourself capable. You're not going to want to fight to be part of it equally. And I think that this is what has really, in terms of leadership, we keep erasing the efforts of Ghanaian women in leadership, Ghanaian women in struggle. So it's like Ghanaian women can achieve a lot of things. You know, this is a society that believes that women must be educated. But when it comes to leadership, when it comes to leading struggle, when it comes to leading movements, somehow the gap in number one, whether we think we are capable, number two, whether the environment, the cultural and the patriarchy allows us to lead. And this is why we must talk about, we must broaden the lens on how we look at our own, on how we look at people's contribution to our independence struggle. So the first thing is that when you say, oh, Big Six, Kwame Nkrumah and the rest, it assumes that they did everything. But it's not possible for Nkrumah to have left point A to even go to point B in Accra. Somebody would have had to drive him. When he woke up, somebody must do the logistics. So when we erase these things, we only make it as if only some people and others, maybe in total 20 people, you know, people like R.S. Blaine, Nana Kobnenketia, all of them men, were the ones who did this full time. Nobody ever talks about money. And if you do not have money, you cannot do a movement. Somebody must fund movement. Somebody must fund mobilization. Somebody must fund even food that must be given at meetings. And so when we look at money, and nobody talks about money, when we look at money and funding, one of the great stories about women in our independence struggle is Agnes Oforiwate Gukwakupong, who was a makola trader. I mean, she was amazing in the sense that she her own business was very profitable. I don't want to say she was not just a makola woman, because that's a lot, but she leveraged her position as a businesswoman, as a trader, to get more education. She was, I think she was one of the first to have opened a bank account with what would later become Standard Chartered. And she funded Kwame Nkrumah, she funded CPP, she funded the movement, all the way up until, you know, the coup. She was very instrumental. Part of erasing women is that it also makes us if our leaders cannot even be described as feminist. In the sense that Kwame Nkrumah, I don't know about the other people, Kwame Nkrumah always made a thing about women's participation. And he also, I mean, he did a lot about affirmative action, as we know, in one of the elections and parliament. But he was funded by Makola women. And in fact, the narrative about Makola women is it's always there. You know, when we have coups, the first thing people want to look at is Makola women. Because of power, because of money, it's either they want to get money from Makola women or they want to victimize Makola women. There's a good friend of my mother's, Mrs. Brenya, who didn't go to school, came down to from the hills of Ikwapem to the port when they were building the port, became a mogul. She's alive now. And she has funded a lot of people, a lot of political parties. She is very politically engaged. The idea that Makola women and women business women, all they wanted to do was money, is because everybody has tapped into their power. And so we are very fortunate that not only, so it's not just an assumption that CPP or the independence struggle, people would have been funded by women business people or, you know, Makola traders. It is a fact in the story of Agnes Tego Kwakupong. I mean, she was instrumental, influential. We can imagine that if she wanted to influence policy, she would have influenced policy because she was a financier of the party, of the movement, you know, or in all the ways that people think financiers have control and financiers have power and they can influence. It's not going to be possible for you to just go into her home, her business, and say, you know what, today we are going to do some campaign in, you know, Tamale, give us money, and she's just going to give you the money without influencing. So she also had influence. She also had power in that sense. And it's a great story. I mean, there are others, but it's a great, great story. Lately, I have been so taken over by just the realization of how much labor Ghanaian and African women do on this continent and how we are socialized to do that labor. And how, I mean, from the time you are like 5 years old as a girl, you know the labor you are going to have to do. And how we even do it without even realizing you are doing the labor. And the insidious patriarchy that we have in Ghana actually says that, yes, Ghanaian women, so you know how education is supposed to provide empowerment, right? Education does empower. But here in Ghana, educated, it doesn't matter how educated you are, how much money you have, right? The society still expects you to do the labor. And privileged women are doing the labor. Poorer women are doing even more labor. And the cost of that labor in their lives curtails economic advancement. It curtails all sorts of freedom. It affects our bodies, our minds. We are doing labor. And so when you come to talk about independence struggle, already in a society that's, it just devalues the labor that we bring, then we wouldn't be recognized. But also, somebody was like, well, do people know, we must teach society and men to value the labor. I said, they know. People know what this labor is about. It's the labor that makes economies run around the world. Capitalism depends on women's unpaid labor. We must continue to have dialogue with Ghanaian women. We must continue to have the kinds of conversations that makes people see and make it possible for them to even, you know, we must imagine what freedom must be like. And we must find ways within our culture, in our homes, to free ourselves and particularly to not burden our daughters.